thank you very much for joining us here on this very special session at the Hindustan Times Leadership Summit. Frederico Marchetti, a pleasure speaking to you, albeit online. We would have liked to have you here in India. I believe you've never visited, so it would have been nice to have you here with us in India. But thanks very much for joining us. You know, as Sunetra was pointing out in that introduction, you're a man ahead of the curve. You bought into the idea of bringing technology to the fashion world almost two decades ago. Even today, the fashion world is only grudgingly taken to technology. What made you want to bet on technology? You've been called the geek of chic. What made you the geek of chic?
Thank you, Shireen, for the question. It was 99, and I wanted to become an entrepreneur. So coming from, some experiences and after my MBA at Columbia University. And I thought that one day fashion was going to intercept technology and the internet especially, because those two worlds in 99, they were completely separate, but they needed someone, a kind of an interpreter or a link to bring them together. And that's what has been my role in the last 20 years. Basically, I've been trying to combine luxury with technology over the 20 years with many, many brands that have done their online debut with me and with my company, Yoox and Net-a-Porter and so on. And it's coming probably from the fact that my inspiration, my philosophy has always been to find a good balance between a human and the machine. Mm. So which is not, given that luxury is an industry that is all about emotions, quality and beauty, while technology is all about process, data and speed, I think it's important to find a good balance between the two, because if you move too much into technology, then you can alienate the luxury shoppers. And if you are too much luxury without having any technology, maybe you're just missing the biggest trend ever in the fashion industry, which is the digitalization of it.
You know, I'll talk to you a little bit more in detail on the digitization attempts by the fashion industry. And I guess it's good reason that Forbes magazine calls you the data file. But let me ask you about this this union that you speak of technology and luxury and what it means now in a post-pandemic world. You said in an interview that people love to shop in the old ways as much as they love to shop in the new ways. So, you know, for people who are at this point in time saying that, look, the way that we've shopped in malls and boutiques, that era is now over on account of what COVID has done to the business. Do you believe that we're writing premature obituaries? What do you believe the future of fashion could look like in a post-pandemic world?
We have seen a huge acceleration. So my company operates also the so-called online flagship store division, which is something which was an idea within the innovation of mine that came in 2005, so 15 years ago, when after launching Yoox, I thought that the brands wanted to have their own monobrand shop. No, so Armani.com powered by Yoox Net-a-Porter, or Valentino.com powered by Yoox Net-a-Porter. And it was 15 years ago. So now we see with the pandemic a huge acceleration of this division, not only because some of the physical shops in some countries have been closed, but also because I think the digital shop, the quality, the service, the content, the entertainment of the digital shops have improved dramatically compared to 2000 when I came up with the first idea. And sometimes I have to say that the digital shops are even better than the physical shops. But this doesn't mean that the physical shops will disappear. I think, as I said before, I think that there will be a balance between going into physical shops or going into digital shops. And probably the holy grail and the final solution will be to integrate them perfectly. Yes. If you are a customer, the same customer that is buying online and is buying offline. And that's actually what we've been working on with Valentino, for example, since almost 4 years in the so-called project Next Era, because it's really the next era of retail, because basically it's a completely seamless integration between online and offline. So the two worlds will continue to coexist. So, because I think even if I'm a tech guy, even if I'm a digital guy, I'm still sometimes having pleasure in going to a physical shop, or I'm still having pleasure to listen to some vinyls, because sometimes the music is better on the vinyls than on Spotify. So I think that it's human nature. We will make some progress, and definitely the mix will change between digital and physical. So now the digital is still not the majority and will grow. But the physical shops will continue to exist.
Yes. So, you know, since you're talking about this happy coexistence, I want to talk to you about what digital could mean now in terms of customer acquisition, in terms of customer engagement from a luxury brand perspective. And more importantly, how is digital driving decision making? How is data driving decision making, even from a design perspective? Are we seeing enough of that? Should we see more of that?
So that's, let's say, the project that I've recently launched with a lot of success with His Royal Highness, the Prince of Wales, called Modern Artisan. So the idea, everything started in Scotland when Prince Charles invited me over for a dinner. And he asked me to come up with an idea of a project to do together, Italy and Britain together. And so I went home and I started thinking which kind of project I could do with His Royal Highness. No, it was not an easy task, let's put it this way. And immediately came to my mind the fact that craftsmanship was definitely something that we both care. Because in Scotland, the artisans are disappearing, no? In a way, it's an old job, an old tradition. Same story for Italy and probably also in India. I mean, you have a long tradition of craftsmanship. The second component of the project was about sustainability, because, I mean, Prince Charles has been a champion of sustainability since decades. I've been focusing on sustainability since 2009, so like, let's say, ahead of the curve of the fashion brands thinking about making sustainable collections. And so that was definitely another important part of the project. And then the last part, which goes back to your question, was about data, because Prince Charles definitely has never been so much focused on technology. So that part was, the thing that I could contribute to the project. And my thinking was, if we were adding data and technology and digital to this collection, also in the creative process, not only we were inventing a new job, the one of the modern artisan, no? So also to attract the young generation to become artisans again, no? So to make it cooler, make it cool again in a way. And so to revive this old job through modern tools, but also through data and technology to make sure that this collection is fully sustainable at its heart. For example, by reducing the waste, because if you can meet the customer needs and the customer demand with a collection, it means that you create less waste. If you can have the right sizes through the use of algorithm or artificial intelligence, it means that you're going to have less waste. So not only through fabrics, materials, organic, the best cashmere from Scotland, the best silk from Lake Como. So not only through this, but also through technology, because my belief has always been that in order to become really more and more sustainable, you need to use technology. And you need to use the progress and the advancement coming from technology. And it proved to be like that, because in the end, the final result is this collection, fully sustainable, that has been created, powered by data, So 5 years of data of our company in terms of customer data, images. Imagine that now we have 36 million images that we have accumulated in terms of fashion in the last 20 years. So these are young artisans, these young students, both from Scotland and Italy, they've been able to understand our customers buying their collection through this data during the process. And which means that they've come up with a timeless collection because they've seen the long-term trends coming from our data. And so the camel coat for men, as well as the midi length for women, and so on. So that's the project about. And I believe that that's the next revolution for fashion. So 20 years ago, I came up with the idea of bringing fashion online.
Yeah.
Now, 20 years later, my idea is through the use of data, I think that fashion can transform and become more and more sustainable.
Mm-hmm. Since you're talking about this this revolution that you hope the fashion world will see, and sustainability will become a part of decision making for every fashion house and every fashion brand, where are we on the scale today in terms of an inflection point from an industry perspective? I mean, you were a pioneer when it came to technology. You perhaps have been a pioneer when it comes to sustainability. But from an industry perspective, you know, we're so used to the idea of fast fashion. How do you slow it down? And are enough moves being made to do that? You know, I was looking at some data that you, in fact, put out since we're talking about data. You said, do you know it takes 1,200 liters of water to make one single cotton sock? I didn't know that. I don't think most people know that. Is there a higher degree of consciousness today, not just with brands, but even with consumers? And how can brands help drive this consciousness?
Yes, the answer is yes. Thank goodness there is more and more consciousness about this issue from both brands and consumers. So, for example, during the recent Cyber Monday, we've seen a boom in sales for everything that is sustainable in our offer, both at Net-a-Porter and at Yoox. At Net-a-Porter is called Net Sustain, at Yoox is called Yooxygen. So two areas focus on sustainable fashion. And definitely, I think the pandemic has been an accelerator of this consciousness, as well as the digitalization of the brands, but also the sustainability part. Probably fashion has been a bit late in recognizing that, but definitely the fashion brands and the fashion creatives, the big fashion groups are definitely catching up.
Mm-hmm. You're saying that they're catching up. You know, you're working with many brands, of course, within your own group. You're also on the board of Armani, for instance. How are fashion, luxury fashion brands today looking at the idea of sustainability, looking at the idea of attracting younger customers, looking at deeper penetration into markets like India? China has emerged as one of the biggest luxury markets in the last few years. Do you believe that, you know, do you see India opening up perhaps as a big market as well?
I mean, we ship to India as one of our 180 markets. Definitely, there are still some barriers and constraints in terms of customs, in terms of time of delivery and so on. So I think that the customer experience is not optimal yet. We focus as a priority on China, because in 2018 I've done together with Richmond and Mr. Rupert, the visionary entrepreneur behind our shareholder, we've done a joint venture with Alibaba in China, and I believe that India has a huge potential. So we still need to work on it, let's put it this way, as a priority for the group, but definitely never say never.
Never say never, and we have to get you to visit India before that. But
I can wait to come to India. And my concept about India is that when I come, I would like to stay 3-4 weeks, because I have a feeling that India will be, let's say, very intense for me, and that I cannot stay for 3 days as I usually I have my trips now. So I go to Hong Kong for 24 hours. India, I think, deserves a long time.
Yes.
And in 20 years, I never had 2-3 weeks together of holidays. So now that I'm chairman, maybe I will find the time to come to India.
And yes, no longer have CEO's role to have to look after. As chairman, you perhaps can take a little bit more time off for yourself. And yes, I assure you, India will require a lot more than 24 hours. You will not be able to capture it in even a few days. You will need a few weeks to be here. But, you know, since you were talking about emerging trends, what digitization and sustainability, if these are some of the mega trends that the fashion industry is learning to work its way through, what else do you believe will be the drivers of growth and will be the drivers of change?
Yeah, another big trend that we've seen, which I'm very happy to tell you the truth, and also goes back to your question about fast fashion. So my company, since 20 years, is at the opposite of fast fashion now, because it's like a luxury is meant to last more than just one season. But recently, especially in the last 6 months, we've seen a big increase in everything that is timeless and investment pieces. So the brands that they are doing the best are those brands with the top quality, with the most luxurious touch in terms of fabrics, not necessarily the big logos, but the brands that and the items that people can wear from generation to generation, and not only from season to season, including jewelry, watches in this category. And is the same concept of the modern artisan, that is more contemporary than ever, because in the end, using data, what the students and the artisans have spotted are these long-term trends. And it's exactly what's going on in our current trading. So the brands that are focused on that are the ones most successful.
So not season to season, but generation to generation, hopefully. That's the way forward. That's the trend that you believe brands will need to focus much more on. You know, since we're talking about life in a pandemic, most of us, or at least a majority of people, have been stuck behind computer screens like this one that we're currently on Zoom calls of one kind or another. And we've seen a big surge or a big boom in leisure wear, sweatpants going glam. What do you make of what you've seen as far as fashion is concerned in the last few months?
I promise that I'm wearing my full suit.
You'll have to stand up and twirl
during the conference. And I mean, definitely what you said is what's happening. But if I can add something, let's say, more curious, and probably that we haven't read everywhere, is about beauty. So beauty, for example, is a category that on Net-a-Porter is flying, probably during these COVID times, in the sense that people, they wanted to look good also on Zoom. And also male beauty and skincare is one of our hottest and highest growing category among our assortment. I have to say that to look good on videos and to look good on the Instagram, so this is a fashion to show rather than fashion to wear. It's not such it's not something that is completely new, because also in the I was telling recently that also in the 18th century, people, they used to have paintings with the famous painters, and they were wearing the clothes just for that painting, yeah, and not to go out. So now, rather than painting, we have Instagram or we have Zoom, but in the end, it's the same story.
It is. Since you talked about Instagram, what has social media done to the fashion industry? What do you believe it can do for the fashion industry? How do you see this happy union, working in the future?
I mean, my friend Eva Chen, that she's the person responsible at Instagram of the fashion brands, and she's been sitting in our board for a long time, and she's such a smart woman, and that actually recently she just interviewed Obama in her Instagram, and it's so funny. She did a great job. We've done a lot of things together, also to convince brands to be launched on Instagram and to exploit, for example, the innovation of Instagram. For example, Net-a-Porter was one of the very, very, very first retailers online that was using the shopping feature on the Instagram. I believe that Instagram is, in a way, replacing more and more the print magazines. So for that, it has been definitely disruptive of the publishing industry. So people, they probably do search or look more at the Instagram rather than go to the newsstand and buy some publications that we all know and that have been very famous in the past, that now they've lost a little bit of their relevance.
Yeah. Well, speaking of relevance, you know, how have you seen e-commerce change in the past two decades since the time that you actually took fashion to took the internet to fashion, or took fashion to the internet? Now, from a customer acquisition point of view, you know, the touch and feel, more engagement. How do you believe things are changing in the online world when it comes to fashion brands?
You know, I think that quality, when I started in 2000, there was the modem at 56K speed. So there was definitely a different time. Now we're talking about 5G, about high speed, and the quality has completely changed. And what we can do through the technology in terms of content and entertainment is really amazing. So for example, one of the feature that is the most successful, for example, at Yoox, because for now it's only at Yoox and not at Net-a-Porter yet, is the so-called Yoox Mirror, where we're combining artificial intelligence with augmented reality. And basically, customers can try on the clothes within the app of Yoox. And basically, the usage has skyrocketed in the last couple of months when we launched the new version, simply because of people, they wanted to have fun. And I think entertainment is part of our proposition. So we are not just a shopping site, we are media in a way, no? So I always thought that we are a entertainer. So which is a mix between entertainer and e-tailer. And that's what in the end, that's what and actually after my Columbia Business School, I wanted to work as an entertainment company in movies production and so on. So in the end, that's more or less what I'm still doing.
So that's a nice term, an entertainer, and you believe that is going to be the future, combining entertainment and retail, because it gives you the flexibility to engage in a much more deeper and fun way, in a cool way with the customer. But how do you see...
I have trademarked this term.
You have trademarked entertainer. All right. So that's Federico Marchetti's trademark, entertainer. But let me ask you about the business side of things. What we have seen is a lot of large retail chains in trouble, either already filing for bankruptcy or on the verge of filing for bankruptcy. You know, we're also seeing a lot of consolidation, perhaps inevitable, given the fact that there is a fair degree of pain in the business today. So what do you see on the business side of the fashion industry over the next few years?
Yeah, you're right. So I always start from the customer, because I'm used to think about the customer first, because also when I started, I invented Yoox as the shop of my dreams. So I was the customer number one, and I still think as a customer more than as a CEO or in the future as a chairman. But you're right, in terms of the business itself, I think that we are in a very fast-paced industry that requires a constant, continuous, and relentless evolution. So if I look at my 20 years career, basically every couple of years, the company that I'm running has changed skin completely now, because at first I started with Europe, and then I launched America, then Japan, and it became immediately international. Then I launched the online flagship store division with Armani.com and so on. Then I opened the Chinese market with JV with Alibaba. Then I did, so basically it's constantly changing. And so I think that the companies that they are in trouble are those ones that they've rejected this constant change. From technology, probably BlackBerry. I was using BlackBerry a lot, like in my, I don't know, in, when I was much younger.
I'm still using one. So clearly I have to take a lesson from what you're saying.
And or other chains or department stores. So I think it's, you needed to change, you needed to evolve. You needed to basically try to anticipate the progress rather than following it. And that's what I've been trying to do over the last 20 years, always to be the first and to arrive first. Even if you arrive first and if you are a pioneer, it means that sometimes you make also some mistakes because you are the first and you don't have anybody to copy. But I've never copied anybody because it's really so distant from my DNA to copy somebody that I love to be the first. It's something that since I was a child, I always loved to be the first.
You know, you talked about being the first, and yes, there are many advantages to being the first mover. But let me ask you, you know, recount for us some of the decisions that you took that perhaps didn't work out as well as you would have liked them to, and how did you deal with that?
I think that innovation, with innovation, there are definitely mistakes. So it's impossible to continue to innovate without making some mistakes and to be tolerant also vis-a-vis the mistakes. So in our organization, the culture of tolerance vis-a-vis mistakes is very important if you continue to innovate and to evolve, as I just mentioned. I just mentioned about the Hughes Mirror.
Yeah.
When we launched the Hughes Mirror 2 years ago, it didn't work out because it was like with a few products, the people didn't look good on the Hughes Mirror, and so it was easy to say, you know what, let's not do it anymore. But I insisted, I changed it, I insisted, I improved it, and now it's working fantastically well. So I think it's important to also not to give up on the innovative ideas that somebody can have.
Innovate and not give up on the dream that you have. Finally, let me end, Federico Marchetti, by asking you, the brands that inspire you, and you can't name yours.
The brand that has inspired me, but I would say not because I'm sitting in the board, and not because I wanted to flatter anybody, but definitely Armani and Mr. Armani has been a source of inspiration for me, because it combines creativity with management and discipline. Which so the brain left and right that we've been talking about for centuries, and there is the perfect combination of those two brains, and so therefore I'm super proud to sit on his board and try to help whenever and wherever is needed.
Well, Federico Marchetti, it's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you very much for sharing your life story as well as your insights on how you get the left and the right to join hands in a much more effective way to ensure not just the survival, but the growth of the fashion world. And of course, sustainability will be key to that as well. Thanks very much. And we hope to see you in India the next time around.
Thank you, Shireen. It was a pleasure for me.